Hello, everybody. It's really good to be here. This is the first talk for the small Christian communities in our first session, which is God Speaks Through Our Ordinary Lives. My name's Paul Krenzelok, and my wife and I are actually new parishioners here at Presentation. We just joined last fall, and right from the beginning, we knew that this was a pretty special place and very hospitable. Currently, I work for the Franciscan Friars of the Atonement up in Garrison, New York, and they're a small community, but what I do is I work with men who are in formation and help them explore their call, and I also do a lot of retreats for young adults, too, with this whole idea of calling and discernment. So I'm very grateful to be asked and have the opportunity to talk to you and start this whole five-week Lenten series with a consideration of what does this whole idea of calling mean? What does it mean to be called? In the young adults I work with, and the adults as well, oftentimes when we think about call, we think about answering the question, what? What am I supposed to do? Maybe what job am I supposed to take? What major am I supposed to take? Or if we're facing a difficult situation in our lives, what am I supposed to do to move through this, to deal with this? Sometimes we maybe even just throw up our hands to God and say, God, tell me, what am I supposed to do? And the whole question of what is really important when it comes to call. There are situations in our lives where we seek to know God's will, God's plan, and we ask God the question, what? Guide me, lead me. But there's a question that's even more primary than the question of what when it comes to call. And that's the question, who? Who am I called to be? Call, first and foremost, is a question of identity. To break this open a little bit, there's a quote that I want to read you, one of my favorites, and it may be one that you've heard, sometimes maybe see on Facebook or the internet. It's one by Marianne Williamson, and it's from her reflection, A Return to Love, Reflections on the Principles of A Course in Miracles. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine like children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God, which is within you. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. That's a very biblical statement, but there are two things in that stand out for me. First is, we are all children of God. That's who we are, that's our identity at its core. And then what flows out of being children of God is a call. We were born to make manifest the glory of God, which is within us. That glory of God is who we are. So it really gets at this question of who. And there are very strong biblical parallels to this, many as a matter of fact. But the one which I think we're all most familiar with would be that from Genesis, Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27. Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our image to be like us." So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. We are made in the image and likeness of God. We hear this fairly often, and we of course read it in scriptures. Yes, we are made in the image and likeness of God. And I don't know about you, but I think sometimes we can just kind of almost let that brush off us and move to the next verse. Oh yeah, we're made in the image and likeness of God. No, wait. We are made in the image and likeness of God. That's amazing. God is our very DNA. The stuff of God is our inheritance. So what is our call? Our call is to be like God. Wow. That almost sounds heretical, to be like God. But it's not. It's because that's who God created us to be like him. God is, as I said, our very inheritance. God is our father, God is our mother, and God passes on to us, the children, God's very being. And it's that being that we then are called to share with the world. If we get the who right, this who, this deep who, which we are called to be, living out of the very essence of God, which is our truest self, all the what's we ask will fall into place. The what's will follow. So it's a pretty tall order to be like God. It's like, okay, how am I supposed to do that? We look to Jesus. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is God become flesh in a human being. We call that, as we know, the incarnation. But oftentimes I think we can make a mistake when we think about that, because we can think, well, yes, God became flesh in Jesus, and we know God through experiencing Jesus. But sometimes we err if we think, well, God became flesh only in Jesus. Jesus is over there, Jesus is God, Jesus is divine, and we're just lumps of coal. But that's not the meaning of the incarnation. The incarnation is that God became flesh in all of God's creation, and most especially in the body of Christ, in you, in me, in all of us. And so what does it mean to be divine, to live out of this divine center? Does to be divine mean to be able to shoot thunderbolts from your finger? Now, that'd be nice. I mean, to be like God, that'd be pretty cool, right? Jesus died for us. But Jesus not only died for us, Jesus invites us to die with him for others. That's the meaning of what it is to be divine, to offer our lives, to lay down our lives for a friend. So the meaning of divine and being divine and living out of this true self, our Christ center, is truly to give our lives away. Our deepest call is to love as Jesus loves. I want to share a little bit of my story about this and what this means to me practically in my life. I've been married for almost 6 years to the love of my life, Michelle, and we met over eHarmony, so cue the eHarmony music, which I can almost hear in my head, and we met in Minnesota, actually, and had a really great year of dating, and at the time when we met, I think I was 47, And especially for all the dating I did in my 20s, 30s, and 40s, I knew, when it was right. And so within a year of when we met, we actually got married. After we got married, within 2 weeks, Michelle was actually called on a job transfer to move from Minnesota to New Jersey, Wayne, New Jersey, which was kind of a shocker. We knew it could come sometime in the future, but it happened 2 weeks after we got married. And it was really stressful. I especially was pulled away from my family. She has more family out here. And I kind of rebelled. And it led into, I have to honestly say, a really difficult first year of marriage. And actually our first 3 years of marriage were really tough. And it wasn't just about that. For all the things and convergences that we had and resonances, we discovered when we lived together as a married couple, we were really, really different and saw the world really differently in a lot of different ways. Yes, there was a deep bond and connection between us that is and always will be, but we faced some real difficulties. And our marriage honestly began breaking down. Our communication began breaking down. It was very, very painful. I would have my talks with God typically on the exercise bicycle at Retro Fitness in the morning. And sometimes if Michelle and I had an argument, I'd be there, biking away and venting and letting God know, just how I'm right. And just trying to work things out. God, tell me, what am I supposed to do? And I would try to figure out all these ways in which I could have the perfect argument and the perfect response. And God would just let me get all of that outside of me, right? Like I'd just go on for 20 minutes of biking. And then all of a sudden, the small, still voice would come. And oftentimes it was this scripture. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. That's Galatians 2:20. And as much as I just want to vent and kind of self-justify myself, which God let me do for a while, this voice kept on coming back and back and stopping me in my tracks. And it was a voice not first about what I was supposed to do to fix the situation or improve it. It was the voice of who I was called to be as Christ, to let go of this ego Paul, the small self, the I, and understand that my deepest me is my Christ nature. It is Christ who lives in me. That had some really practical implications then for the what. For all the ways that I was trying to do the what I was called to do to make this marriage better on my own terms, God was leading me to deeper whats. God was leading me to the what of just being with Michelle, just being with Michelle. God was leading me to the what of softening my heart. God was leading me to the what of looking at my behaviors, of understanding and looking at the log in my eye while I criticized, the speck in Michelle's. God was leading me to the what of listening, but not listening to give advice as I was prone to do, but listening just to support and hear Michelle's pain. It's very profound, and it's a path that both of us are still on, which things are so good these days. And those whats were grounded in the who. They were grounded in the who of who we are called to be, that we are called to be not I, not our small selves, but our deepest Christ nature. We're called to be like God. We are called to understand that our deepest selves are embedded in Christ. So as we begin these 5 weeks, I invite you to think about this and to think that as we consider the context of our lives and all the ways in which we're called, the broader call is an invitation to an identity. It's an invitation to who we are called to be, to understand that our deepest selves are truly our Christ selves. And that if we get the who right, the what will follow. And I also want to say that this call to be like God, to be like Christ, it's not a generic call. We don't all call and manifest the glory of God, as Marianne Williamson said, in the same way. Each of us are called. The very beautiful window as we walk into our parish says, I have called you by name. I have called you uniquely. Each one of us fulfills a purpose to manifest God in a way that nobody else does or can. We are all called uniquely. And as we explore in these next 5 weeks, we'll be doing and reading a book written by Dr. Kathleen Cahalan. And she focuses on 8 prepositions. They are for, from, by, to, as, through, in, and within. And through each of these prepositions, she delves into the context of our lives, the stories of our lives, because each of our lives is a story. And it's through our unique story, it's through our unique circumstances that we understand and grow into the way in which God calls each of us uniquely. So, here we go. We invite you to these next 5 weeks, and may God bless you as you delve into understanding how you are called by name.